you very much for giving me a chance to talk at this seminar. I don't know how I'm Spanish, so, but I'm a gas volcanologist, and so today I'm going to talk about the remote SDI observation carrying out at Sakurajima volcano, Japan. So before going on, I'd like to introduce where I'm from, and I'm from Geochemical Research Center at the Graduate at the University of Tokyo. This is a very small center between, so it's not in a department of Earth Planetary Science or a department of chemistry, but it's in between and special center for dealing with geochemistry. And our target investigation of dynamics of the Earth's and planets chemical point of view. And we have both our center. So one is the Noble Gas and Cosmochemistry Group. And this is very strong laboratory for noble gases. We have like 3 or 4 mass spectrometers only dedicated to noble gas measurements. I think it's one of the best noble gas laboratory probably in the world. And anyway, there's another group like Geochemistry of the Earth's Interior, which is dealing with high pressure materials. And I'm in a volcanic fluid research group, and also there is a crustal gas research group. It's crustal gas research group is more working on groundwater, radon monitoring of groundwater, especially for, like, used to do more like earthquake prediction. But it's now to understand much more about what's happening in the crust. Anyway, I'm in the book research group, but even I say group, staff member is one, so only me. And I have at the moment only one student here, and fortunately another one student is joining, so I have 2 students from April. So it's a very small group, so what we can do is very limited. So, and our group has been doing is like, it started in 1980s, so at the VCRC, we started volcanic gas work in 1980s, but at that time it was more like helium 3 and 4 ratio of volcanic gas and geothermal fluid. And then when I joined in 1990s, my professor gave me a chance to work with FTIR. So I started the remote FTIR observation of volcanic gas in early 1990s. Then in late 1990s, one post from Spain came to our lab and started doing diffuse CO2 survey at the volcano. So we did that quite at many volcanoes, like, and we had like nice, we detected a nice change of CO2 flux before like Usu volcano, like in 2000. And early 2000, like we had in 2000, there was an eruption of Miyakejima, which emitted 10,000 tons per day of SO2 every day, Miyakejima. But at that time, we were using COSPEC, an instrument called COSPEC, but we wanted a new instrument, but we couldn't get COSPEC at that time, so people wanted to introduce UV spectroscopy methods, mini DOAS, to Japanese volcanoes, so I did a lot of work on in early 2000 on that. And then, as I was doing copy of UV, I wanted to do, I thought it was nice to image SO2 somehow. And then in late 2000, I started developing of SO2 visualization techniques using UV cameras. So what I can say is at our center, we did pioneering work of CIR and SO2 camera for volcanic gas study. And probably this is one big point of our laboratory. And now carry out volcanic investigations using these techniques here to understand the dynamics of, as you say, volcanic eruption or the dynamics of degassing. So today I'm talking about Sakurajima volcano. So first I want to introduce about the Sakurajima volcano. For those of you who came to IAPTE meeting in last year in Kagoshima, maybe you know what Sakurajima is, but Sakurajima is a volcano in the Kyushu Island. I didn't bring the whole Japanese map, but probably you know Kyushu Island. Anyway, it's in southernmost part of Kyushu Island. Sakurajima is here. So this is a map of Sakurajima volcano, and this used to be an island, maybe until 100 years ago. But the activity 100 years ago, the lava flow connected this part, and it's no more island. But you can see this part is city of Kagoshima, which is about, it has about population of 600,000. And Sakurajima is just 10 kilometers from the city. So if something happens, I mean, it quite influenced this city. So this is some eruption columns of Sakurajima, so, seen from the city side. So in the city, if there is eruption, you can see the plume like this from the city. And when the wind direction is good, which means wind direction is going far away from the city, there's no problem. But when the wind is blowing tight, and this city is completely covered with ash. So people have to deal with ash all the time in this city. But when we go back to the volcano, this volcano is here, and the active crater at the southern end called Minamidake. This is older cone called Tadaki, and this is active cone is Minamidake. And this Minamidake has been has intermittent volcanic eruption since 1950. But in 2006, another crater here called Showa crater, just like 600-700 meters from the Minamidake, reactivated in 2006. And now this Showa crater is the center of activity, and it gives a very frequent volcanic eruptions now. And anyway, this is the Sakurajima volcano, and there are two active craters. And this is a view from the east. And as you can see, this is a Showa crater, and this is Minamidake crater. And so there are two plumes at this volcano, not one crater, I mean two craters emitting the plume. And this is an eruption of Atsu Sakurajima volcano since 2006, especially Atsu Showa crater. So as you can see, this is the number, monthly eruption number of Showa crater. So as I said, Showa crater deactivated June 2006, but there were only two eruptions at this time. And 1 year later, started again. Another 1 year later, activated again. And from 2009, eruption is like this. I mean, and like annual number of explosions is nearly 1,000, like in 2011 and 2012. 12. So many eruptions now. And here I say eruptions, explosions. And this is just a size. Explosion is just bigger eruption. And it's kind of defined by some meteorological agencies based on seismicity and based on some height, not height, acoustic phones, infrasound. But anyway, as you can see, there are so many eruptions at this volcano now. And this is the eruption of the last 60 years. And from 1950s, there have been lots of eruptions from the Minamidake crater. And Minamidake crater, but it started to decrease in after year 2000. And then in 2006, Showa crater reactivated. Now the eruption center is completely moved to Showa crater. But as you can see, the number of eruptions at Showa crater is so huge now. But this is the emission rate of ash, yearly emission rate of ash. From this part is from Minamidake crater, and this part is Showa crater. So although the number of eruptions at the Showa crater is larger compared to Minamidake, the amount of ash is smaller in Showa crater. So that means the Minamidake crater used to be much, much larger, but the Showa crater has many eruptions, but the size is not so big. This is also activity of Sakurajima, and the last one here is sulfur dioxide flux in tons per day. And as you can see, the emission of Sakurajima for sulfur dioxide is about 1,000 to 2,000 tons per day, usually. But it sometimes increases over 4,000 and 5,000. So it's quite emitting a lot of gas at Sakurajima. Now I'd like to talk about volcanic gas studies which have been done at Sakurajima. And as I showed, because there are so many frequent explosions and eruptions at this volcano, we are not able to go up and collect gas samples. So there is not so much volcanic gas sampling data at this volcano. So not so much information about the volcanic gas composition. And for SO2 flux, cost-spec measurement has been done from 1970s, and now like mini DOAS measurement has been done quite often by Japan Meteorological Agency, as I showed here, since 2003. And there has been lots of trials for gas composition measurement, and like especially in late 1970s and 80s by Professor Hirabayashi. And they used to use like UAV and evacuated bottle, so they had a remote control airplane that went into the sky and the evacuated bottle, and then do the analysis for the gas composition, or like a jet for volcanic gas absorbed onto, or also they use alkaline traps or like gas sensors at the flank, and another FTIR measure for volcanic gas composition. And I saw some data from Hirabayashi et al. In 1982, and this is from the radio monitor, radio controlled airplane. Or this is like alkaline trap or ash leachate. And also they had so what they are measuring is HCl SO2 ratio, and in most of the case the ratio is 0.2 to 1 point something, and they say it changes with activity. But since the measurement was not measurement, gas was most of the case, gas was not sampled, but monitored like 3-4 kilometers away from the volcano. We don't know what kind of change has been done between the, you know, between the crater and the flank. So it's sometimes very difficult to explain the changes here. And this is also some measurement of HCl-SO2 ratio with the sensors at the flank. And but the range is basically between 0.1 and they say it's also very rapid, but it's sometimes difficult to understand. Anyway, most of the data I expressed was, as I said, sampled kilometers away from the crater and not in the center of the plume. So we don't know, we really don't know what is the real value for this volcano. And also, these data are before 2006, so it's data for Minamidake crater, not Showa crater, which is currently active one. And so, when I wanted to start FTI measurement, so my question was, what is the current composition, volcanic gas composition at Showa crater? And is it different from Minamidake or not? So that was the main purpose for starting the FTIR measurement at this volcano. Before going on to the measurement at Sakurajima, so I just talked briefly about the remote FTIR measurement at the volcanoes. So volcanic gas measurement using a remote FTIR was first applied at Unzen Volcano, Japan, in 1991 for HCl and SO2 detection. And with the advantage of FTIR measurement is of, we can measure many kinds of gas species. And we can measure SO2, hydrogen chloride, HF, even CO, COS, and SiF4, CO2, H2O. So quite many gases of volcanic gas. And also the good part is remote FTIR we can obtain volcanic gas composition of the plume from 100 meters away, 10 kilometers away, or maybe more. And so we don't have to go up the mountain to get the samples. So I'm basically doing haven't done so much work with detection of with FTIR. So I usually use infrared absorption in the measurement. So, and in order to measure infrared absorption, of course, we need an adequate light source for measuring the absorption of the volcanic gas component. And for the light source for open pass. There's some kind of light source, and like Frank Zetto 1995 used artificial light source, and also a high temperature lava or temperature fumarolic ground used as light source, and also the sunlight or scattered sunlight is used for the light source. Also, I only know one result, but the moonlight can for that as a light source. Anyway, important thing is to have light source is very important to do the infrared absorption of volcanic gas. And this is some photos from measurements at the Aso volcano. So here, fortunately, I can go to the summit area, looking down to the crater. And on this side, at the target, there is a fumaroic area with high temperature ground, and I'm using this high temperature ground as a light source and measuring the volcanic gas in between the light source and instrument. And this is one of the pictures at the Asama volcano, using the sun, the light source. And these are the old instrument I was using with Bowman instrument. Anyway, I mean, the instrument itself is quite heavy, and so I needed a car to go to the location to do the measurement. This is some spectra from, I think this was Oppenheimer 1998 paper, and this was spectra, infrared spectra, and this one is using artificial light source and with distance of 600 meters, and this is spectra with using the sun. For these two spectra, they are for the detector, they use the indium antimonide detector, so it is sensitive to probably above 1,800. Anyway, as you can see, many gas species or volcanic gas can be seen in this area. But also, these H2O here, of course, in volcanic gas, but these are almost, especially for the long path measurement, these are of atmospheric, not from volcanic gas, so it's usually, especially for the long path measurement, it's very difficult, I think it's very difficult to get information of volcanic water or CO2. This is one of the measurements measured at a volcano with like this, so it's short distance of about 200 meters with inhumed antimonide detector, and this spectrum is very easy to see sulfur dioxide, so there is here sulfur dioxide here, and also HCl here, and this is absorbance spectrum, observed absorbance at a volcano, and if you calculate the absorbance, you can clearly see SO2 and like HCl, and at this volcano short distance, I could see here like carbon monoxide or like COS, and also one peak of a few peaks of carbon dioxide like here. So if the spectrum is like, it's very easy to do the spectrum analysis for these gases. At Sakurajima volcano, I'm now using a MIDAC instrument, FTR system from MIDAC company, and this one has a resolution of 0.5 wave number, and I'm still using the antimonide detector, and for the light source I use since Sakurajima the cone cannot go to the summit, and I don't see any hot surface at this volcano, I'm using sun as a light source, solar occulte source. Also, this measurement, I don't use a telescope for the FTIR. I just put a mirror in front and change the mirror direction that the sunlight goes directly into the spectrometer. So the important thing, I have to go to the location where I can align the sun and plume and observation site in a straight line, so that I can have information of volcanic plume. So now the instrument is very, not so, it still is heavy, like 20 kilograms, so, but I just carry it by myself with small car and do the measurement. So I change the location during the measurement to find a good place so that I can line the sun and the plume and the instrument. And this is one of the photos with the sunlight here But also, because the sunlight is so strong, I usually put metal, how do you say, mesh in front so that I can reduce the strong intensity of the sun. And this is one of the observed spectrums with using the inhuman antimonide detector. And as I said, this is using the sun, so I have no light around here, also here, due to atmospheric H2O and CO2. And so what I'm showing here for S and around here for HCl. So this is a larger view of the spectrum at around here from 2400 to 2900 wave number, and you can see absorption of H2 here, and there should be absorption of HCl here, but I cannot see because of the other interference of H2O with my eyes, but if you do spectral analysis, you can see the HCl clearly here. So this is one of the spectrum fitting I'm doing for the red one is observed. Blue one is observed spectrum, and the red one is model spectrum with considering atmospheric absorption and volcanic gas absorption. And you can see this is SO2, this is a residual, and this is for spectrum fitting for measuring HCl. And I don't remember which was HCl peak, but anyway, fitting is doing quite well with some amount of HCl. So, first at Sakurajima in 2009, I started doing measurements with a downwind plume about 3 kilometers away from the volcano. And so this is a plume from the Sakurajima, and there is near the observation view from the observation site. Actually sun is in another direction, and I looked at the sun through the plume and measured sulfur dioxide and HCl. And this is one of the results on this day. And this is SO2 amount, and this is HCl amount in the vertical. And it's in the unit of ppm, but assuming the plume length of 1000 meters. So it's average, if the plume is 1000 meters width, this is going to be the average concentration. Anyway, as you can see, it has some correlation, positive correlation. But if I try to calculate the ratio, HCl-SO2 ratio, so it gives like as a fitting, linear fitting, it gives like 0.16. But as you can see, there is some, how do you say, variation between 0.1 and like 0.24. This is the time on December 2nd of 2009. So this is SO2 amount, and this one is HCl-SO2 ratio. And as you can see, HCl-SO2 ratio changes between 0.1 and 0.2. And this is because, as I showed, this is because, as you can see from the here, Showa crater and Minamidake crater has both have plumes. So, and it seems they have different HCl-SO2 ratio. So, with the downwind plume measurement, Yes, I get some values of HCl SO2 ratio, but it's changing, and we don't know what the values for each plume, each equator. And with this downwind measurement, it's difficult to estimate the individual ratio for the two craters because the plume is mixed. So then, I wanted to know, you know, the ratio for the each plume. So I decided to change my measurement method. So I decided to use when the sun sets. So this sun sets above the, behind the crater. So like when the wind direction from here. This is a view from like looking towards west of west towards Sakurajima, and if I go to some location that sun goes down like this with the view from Minamidake and Showa crater, then with this sun track, the sun going down, I can measure if the Minamidake is higher and Showa crater is lower, I can measure the HCl SO2 ratio of Minamidake plume from when the sun is here. And when the sun goes down close to the Showa crater, I can see more of the Showa crater information. Or if it's like, if the sun goes down like, you know, it's completely out of Showa crater plume. So in this case, I can measure Minamidake crater's value. And for the case like when the wind direction is opposite and the sun goes down like this, I can get information of Showa crater with around here, not of the information of Minamidake. So by measuring the sun going down behind the crater, I can kind of separately measure HCl SO2 ratio. So, but as you can see, I'm only measuring when the sun is going down. So measurement period is quite short. I mean, I realize the sun really moves quite fast. For like, how do you say? I mean, anyway, I only have a few tens of minutes each day for the measurement. So during the day, try to change location so that I go to the location first to, so that the sun goes down like this. Like this first. Measure the Minamidake crater's plume, and then move quickly to another location. The sun goes like this line to measure the Showa crater, so that I can measure both in the same day. So this is the location of FTIR measurement. So since I usually make measurements not in the morning, after when the sun goes down, so the other location, this is Minamidake crater and Showa crater here, and I usually make measurements about 5 kilometers away, and like selecting these points for the measurement. Actually, these are quite many locations around here. You cannot see the volcano, so there are only limited points like 10 points that I can make measurements. And these locations are selected due to plume condition, wind direction, and of course the season, time of the year. So this is one of the example on December, November 19th, 2009. On this day, plume is going up and going to the left. And this is a plume from Minamidake, and this is a plume from Showa crater. And the sun was like this on this day. And since the Minamidake crater was going quite high up, just before the sunset behind the volcano, I could measure the Showa crater. And this is the result on this day. And this is SO2 amount with the time. And this is HCl SO2 ratio. And as you can see, On this day, plume from Minamidake crater, on this photo it looks quite big, but the plume from Showa was much bigger on this day. And as you can see, near to the sunset, there's lots of high SO2. These are from Showa crater. And as you can see, when the Showa crater plume is coming into the view of the spectrometer, it goes down to 0.1. And also, you can see here, these high peaks of SO2 is related to a puff from Showa crater. And when Showa crater puff comes, the value approaches 0.1. So from this, I can estimate that Showa crater has a ratio of 0.1. And for Minamidake, like when the sun was higher, most of the gas was coming from Minamidake, although it's not so much, but at this time, you can see higher ratio, and so at least I can say that Showa and Minamidake has a different value, and Showa has ratio of about 0.1, and Minamidake has higher, maybe above, at least above 0.25 for Minamidake. So these two craters, even if about 700 meters away, they have a different HCl-SO2 ratio. And this is some example last year, 1 year ago. And like I moved to separate locations today. So this was the beginning, mostly measuring Showa crater. And at the end, like here, this is the plume from Showa crater, and the sun is completely outside to the plume of Minamidake crater. So these values are of these plumes are from Minamidake crater. And if I look to the ratio, this is SO2 again, and this is HCl-SO2 ratio. So when their plume is mainly Showa crater, it's like 0.15. And when there is Minamidake gas, it's like 0.35, or like between 0.35 and 0.4 for Minamidake. So like this, I try to measure both plume values for many occasions. And this is a plot of SO2 and HCl column amount. And as you can see, when Showa crater plume is coming, it is mostly like 0.15. Of course, it's some part of Showa Minamidake crater, so there are some bugs here. And when the plume is mostly at Minamidake crater, it gives like nearly about 0.4. So this day, Showa crater was like 0.4, 0.15, and Minamidake crater's ratio was like 0.4. And there were some shared values like 0.1 on this. This was here, giving 0.1. And this peak was one of the puffs from Showa crater. And when this puff came, the ratio came to 0.1. But I don't know why. But maybe I sometimes see two plumes coming up from Showa crater. So maybe even in the Showa crater, it's different. Ratio values or two kind of plumes Showa crater, but this is only one occasion, so I'm not sure about this. And also in Minamidake crater, this is aerial photo of Minamidake crater, and there are two vents called A vent and B vent. I had also several occasions measuring that different HCl-SO2 ratios for two vents, in A vent and B vent in Minami-dake crater. Like this is one of the photo. This is plume of Showa crater, and this is plume. I mean, it's transparent, but wet plume from Minami-dake crater. But when I was making measurements, a small plume, a puff, came up from Minami-dake crater, which gives different ratio. So this means maybe A and B vents in Minami-dake crater is has a different HCl-SO2 ratio. But anyway, this is a summary of my measurements since 2009. And as you can see, all the measurements limited from the end of year to maybe March of the year. And I've been... So there's about 20 craters here, but I have been to Sakurajima maybe more, twice more, even in summertime or... But in summertime, unfortunately, the volcano is quite covered with clouds. Or sometimes there's too much ash and I cannot make measurements. So the data I have of Sakurajima is only this much. But as you can see, this is a white square from Minami-dake, and the black one is circle is from Showa crater. And you can see that Showa crater has a value of from 0.1 to 0.175, but usually between 0.1 and 0.15. So this is kind of some exception, but it's quite stable between this value. But in contrast, like Minami-dake, the HCl ratio usually higher than 0.2 and ranges like from 0.125 to more than 0.4. And so Minami-dake's ratio is, although it's not so much active, it's more changing more. And the Showa crater is more stable for last at 4 or 5 years. And for the variation of Minami-dake crater, this is a daily highest height of Minami-dake observed by the meteorological agency. So this is also a small triangle, the time of the explosion at Minami-dake crater. So even though number is very low, there are like about 6 eruptions at this explosions at Minami-dake crater within last 5 years. And as you can see, between 2010 and 2011, there was one explosion, but there was no plume, visible plume, during the this period at Minami-dake. And if you also see other data, like at Minami-dake, there sometimes you can see the growth, the summit, I mean, how do you say, growing of, if there is a cloud, not cloud, plume, at night, it reflects the light inside the crater. And if when the crater, inside the crater is really hot, sometimes you could see red plume or cloud above at night. And we say that glowing. And this glowing was observed in 2009 and also in 2012. But during this period, no glowing was measured. And also, some observation by airplane. There was a water in the Minami-dake crater. It was observed like several times during this period. So from this, we can estimate that Minami-dake crater was, activity of Minami-dake crater was low during this time. And if you watch the HCl-SO2 ratio, During this period, this ratio was lower compared to here. So from this, I can estimate that variation of temperature greater is more is maybe corresponding over period of Minamidake, and probably related to, since there was a waterfall, probably related to hydrothermal reaction with the volcanic gas and the waterfall, and was decreasing the ratio here. And for Showa crater, I checked many measurements. I compared with many measurements. Like this is only aspect of Showa crater observed by James Wayne. And so, as I said, the Showa crater is quite stable. So it's quite difficult to relate it changes with something. And so this is with the monthly ash emission. This is a comparison with water-soluble components on ash. So it's more similar to it's TLSO ratio of water-soluble components absorbed on ash. So people say it's related to gas composition. But as you can see, this was measured by Tokyo Institute of Technology, and TLSO ratio is from 0.1 to sometimes above 2.5, and very, very big. But seeing the FTR measurement, it's not so much changing as water-soluble component of on ash. So, but maybe the baseline level is the same, but these signals are not probably relating to gas, maybe more to physical condition of absorbing gas onto ash. And I'm not sure, but like in measurements during the 2004 summer eruption, we compared this ash leachate value with the FTIR. At that time, our values at ash leachate was very, how do you say, gave same value. But in Sakurajima, I don't know the reason why, but still the ratio is quite different. And this is just relation with monthly number of eruptions. But one thing I can say is that HLSO ratio of above 0.15, like here, is maybe a little bit related to number of eruptions, but also not so much confident. But like if we count the number of explosions in plus minus days of the measurement, like at this time, the number of eruptions when I made measurement of FTIR plus minus 3 days was zero. But for other periods, when it's giving especially lower values of HCLSO ratios, the number of eruptions in plus minus 3 days is like 9 to 50. So it may be a little bit related, but still I'm not confident what are these changes. This is also comparison with pressure source. So this is a volume increase at pressure source at 4 km depth, estimated from tilt meter. So there was a starting from 2008 and going down at the 2010, and then increase and decrease, and this kind of tilt change is observed at this volcano. Of course, I check with increased periods, but higher value sometimes correspond to increase, but not always. So I still haven't come to any corresponding observation for these changes. But anyway, for possible reasons for HTLS source variation, like we find increasing ratio and decreasing ratio. We have several, can think of several, like in the ratio increase that sometimes means shallower degassing, or like decreasing amount of degas, so then bubble separate the melt coming up separate coming up the condensate. And if this amount of deep gas increases, it will increase ratio. Also, the superficial hydrothermal interaction, this also decrease and increase the ratio. So lower hydrothermal interaction will increase the ratio. And for decrease ratio, the opposite. And for Minamidake, as I said, low scale source between November 2010 and November 2011, probably these are points to low surface of the crater, and it is related to increased hydrothermal. Showa crater is, as I showed, mostly the ratio of Minamidake, so not always, but mostly higher than Showa crater. So I can estimate that more bubble supply for Showa crater, and maybe some supply from basaltic input into the magma chamber. And but compared to Minamidake crater, Showa crater has a stable ratio, 4.1 or 4.15, and maybe considering this, supply from the depth is quite stable at this volcano. And this is some gas emission model that I can from my FTIR results. And it's based on, basically on, based on the magma composition and degassing model. So the magma coming up the condit, and when it degas, if the density becomes heavier and goes down, and like so magma is convecting by Kazahaya et al. 1994, and so this is Showa crater condit, and this is Minamidake crater condit, and currently according to Kazahaya et al., the gas emission of Showa crater is much higher, like several times higher compared to Minamidake. And so we think that the convection is larger at Showa crater at the moment. Also, amount of dust, amount of bubble coming Showa crater condit is much higher than Minamidake crater. And if the HCl-SO2 ratio in the magma chamber, let's consider this the ratio of bulk, and if the, there is some at certain depth, but before the two condits separate, the probably the gas bubble is made inside the condit or the chamber. And in that case, the ratio of the bubble should be lower compared to the bulk, or lower compared to the ratio inside the melt. And if this bubble comes up and also added to the volcanic plume, this means, I mean, how do you say, amount of gas bubble, so amount ratio by degassing, if you know both of them are emitting quite shallow, in this case the ratio should of Minamidake and Showa crater should be the same. But the reason for the difference for these two craters is probably amount of gas coming by bubble is much more for Shoah crater, and this will give lower value of the ratio compared to Minamidake, and this is what I'm thinking for the why the rate is lower in Shoah crater and Minamidake crater. But I'm not still with this model, and have to probably to measurement much more to understand the difference. Also, if there will be a HCl resource ratio for Shoah crater, that will give more better answer. But as I said, for last 5 years, it has been quite stable. So I still don't have come to conclusion. What is the real? What is the reason for the different ratio for the two craters? It's about 600-700 meters, 600 to 700 meters. So Condit is, I'm sure that, I mean, from the geophysical observation, magma chamber is X for these two volcanoes, and some petrologists measured the volcanic bomb, and their composition of the bomb is quite same, similar. So only the gas composition is different at these two craters. So anyway, this summary of my talk. And so I have been doing air measurement 2009, and at the moment, as far as I know, crater has different air resource values, and the decrease of the ratio between 2010 and 2011. For this, I'm quite sure related by hydrothermal interaction by the lower active crater. And the ratio of active crater not shown so big significant change, and maybe reflecting stable degassification of this volcano. And but of course, the problem with my measurement is the number of the measurements is very limited. If I had more here, maybe I saw some changes, but unfortunately, it's very limited. So I have to consider how to increase the measurement at this volcano. And the difference of ratio on the Minamidake crater may be explained by the extent of convection of Condit convection of magma, and for degassing, and also bubble coming out, but I'm not confident with that yet. So I'll continue the measurement at this volcano. Thank you very much.